Great aircraft is nearing the end of her long flight from the old world to the new. After spanning half the earth, she is making her landfall on the Australian coast. There she is, the city of Darwin, northernmost port of Australia. Here, Ross and Keith Smith touched down in 1919 after 30 days of daring, the first to fly from England to Australia. So, fittingly enough, tropical Darwin has become Australia's airport of entry from Europe and Asia. While the overseas liners come and go, the small planes too are busy, taking the crocodile or buffalo hunters to their camps or bringing an injured stockman into hospital. Over there, another liner is getting ready for the big hop across the Timor Sea to Singapore and on to Karachi, Cairo, Rome, and London. But we'll go to town for a look round. It's hot. Really only about 90 degrees in the shade, but the humidity makes it seem more. Darwin has only 6,000 inhabitants, but it is the capital of the vast Northern Territory, one of the bases for the pearling fleets, and outlet for the enormous area of the great cattle lands at the top of the continent. A problem land, rich in promise, but hard and fickle, as many a pioneer, gold miner, or cattle breeder has found at his cost. Tropical living is hard on the complexion, so the beauty parlor is always in demand. And not only the beauty parlor. The Legislative Council, presided over by the administrator, controls the administration of the Northern Territory. Let's go into the council chamber and find out what Darwin's problems are. They must be pretty tough, considering that in 1876, the Northern Territory was nearly sold to the Japs. In 1908, it was taken over by the Commonwealth, which has administered the territory ever since. One of Darwin's main problems is its isolation. All bulk supplies come by sea from Perth and eastern ports, and the ships arrive about three times a month. You pay specially reduced taxes in the territory and have free medical attention. But even so, it's difficult to get men to settle there. Darwin is a long way from the main centers, about 2,000 miles from most of them. By land, well, it's a good plan to take your bed with you, but the road south is excellent. The only railway line stops dead about 300 miles south of Darwin, and then at 650 miles on the Stuart Highway to Alice Springs. Zeros in the tropics, and Mitsubishis too, added to Australia's distrust of Japan. The Japanese, realizing its value as a base from which to bomb Timor and the East Indies, raided Darwin no less than 64 times. Pre-war Darwin was largely a shanty town, but the administration plans to build a new garden city, a garrison town, airport, and tourist center housing 20,000. So far, it's only a plan, but there are glimpses of the future. The many thousands of Australian and Allied troops quartered here during the feverish activity of the war years will be glad to see that work has begun to solve Darwin's housing problems. Pleasant houses built on stilts for coolness. Tree-studded gardens to give the maximum of shade. Everybody going? A corroboree to entertain us. Once a year, tribes from the surrounding districts come to Darwin to stage their dances. Men of the Millingimby tribe dance the first dance. Meanwhile, the war guides are getting ready. Music, famous dancer of the war guides, takes the lead. It's time for us to leave. Our plane is about to take off. Goodbye, Darwin, and good luck.